Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. I am the president of the Arctic Society. We do have a couple events coming up, such as the 5K run, partnering up with the AIA. Just want to let you guys know that there's opportunities out there that give you the chance to volunteer. Speaking of opportunities, let's go ahead and kick off this one and welcome Mr. Moreno.
Thank you very much. What a good turnout. I'm happy to see people here. It's been 3 years since we've actually seen. I mean, we had people last semester, but there was maybe 10 or 15 people, and this is a nice little crowd. I do want to say felicidades. This is Hispanic Heritage Month, and whether you identify yourself as a Mexicano, Colombiano, Peruano, Uruguayo, Puertorriqueño, Hispanic, Chicano, Latino, Latina, or Latinx, that's the latest and greatest, right? Let us be proud of who we are, because unidos, united, we are a force of one. I would like to tell you that when I first started teaching full time in 2007, only 3% of Latin Americans made the represented registered architects. Now in 2021, we are at 10% of represented in as registered architects in the United States. We are still a long ways out, but as I can see here with this nice large group, and of course our friends that are out there in Zoom, we can do this to raise the numbers of Latin American architects represented in the United States. So to begin with, I would like to present to you today a good friend of mine, Eugenio Mesta, known as I know him as Pacelli. I met him in 1990s. We do go way back. When I graduated from Arlington, came down back to El Paso and interviewed with several firms, and Perspectiva was the name of the firm that he headed back then. Eugenio is, or Pacelli, is from Chihuahua, Chihuahua. He got his undergraduates from El Tec de Monterrey and his master's from the University of Pennsylvania. And so from there, I will pass it on to Pacelli.
Good evening. I'm not used to this, and I was hoping there were be fewer of you, so I would be less nervous, but I'm glad you all came. Just to let you know, I have a couple of colleagues from my office, Italia and Alex, who Italia has a master's from UT Austin and a bachelor's from UTSA. And Alex started like you in El Paso Community College, although she is much older. She's like very old. This building didn't exist. So, but from here went to Texas Tech and then has a master's from Berkeley. So there is a lot to see, a lot to learn, a lot to grow into. I want to thank you again for having me, Emmanuel, and for you all coming on a Friday afternoon when you could all be partying. Okay, but I'm going to try to do my best in let you know a little bit about Exigo, let you know a little bit about how we work. I don't consider this to be my projects. I'm the lead designer in the firm. However, there's 16 of us that work together, and as you're going to notice, and you have started in college in the college here, is that a lot of architecture is about collaborating. You're going to learn to collaborate with not only among other architects, but with engineers, with clients, and a lot of a large group of experts that bring a lot to the table as we develop this design of these buildings that that like this one, which are where we live and when we work and where we experience our lives. A little bit about myself, Emmanuel mentioned I'm from Chihuahua. I went to Monterrey to study architecture, and the reason why I studied architecture is because when I was in high school, graduating from high school, in junior high school, actually, junior high, they asked me, and I didn't know they were going to ask me, what did I want to do when I grow up? And I was the second in line. And I didn't know they were going to ask me, so the first thing that came to my mind was architecture. Why? I have no idea. But then I thought, I said I was going to be an architect. I'm going to have to be an architect. So I went through the motions, graduated from high school, went to college. And on my second year in college, I was just going through the motions. I didn't know really that I loved this, what I do. I had a brother that was living in D.C. at the time. So I went to visit him, and I went to see the National Museum of Art done by Ian Pei. And I said, now this is what I want to do. This is what I want to do. First thing that I'm going to pass on to you guys is when you travel, no matter where you go, experience the building. Look at the building. Touch the buildings. Live the buildings. Because that's how you're going to find out whether if architecture is your call. Architecture is not easy. Architecture is hard work. Architecture is not necessarily well paid. However, it is extremely gratifying. Because whatever it is you do, good or bad, it's going to last a long time. It is as easy to do an ugly building as it is to do a beautiful building. And which one do you rather do? If it's going to last 50, 100, thousands of years, like you see, like the great cathedrals in Europe or in Mexico, for that matter. So I went to college. I graduated from college, and then I had a professor who enticed me into doing my master's. And I said, I just wanted to graduate. He enticed me into going. He had gone to Cornell. He said, you need to go to Cornell. I applied to Cornell. They didn't accept me. But I applied to 10 universities, and three accepted me. Berkeley, boo, Rice, and Penn. And I was smart enough to pick Penn because it was the farthest away from Chihuahua. That's how scientific was my thought. So I got to Penn, and I got to be with a bunch of students from all over the world. And I was for sure enough that I was going to flunk. I said, I'm never going to make it. These guys are as smart as Alex and Italia. And I'm not going to make it. And I really, for a while, I wasn't making it. But then, slowly but surely, got to here. So finally, I graduated from my master's, went to Chihuahua, couldn't find a job, got a job here for 6 months. And it's been 39 years. So I opened my firm in 1990, closed it in 2011, started over in 2013, in 2011. In Exigo. Enjoy the ride, guys. Architecture is a ride. So I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the projects that we have done. Some of you might recognize them. The last one, the one that you see here, which is Mexican-American Cultural Center, September, Heritage Month, Hispanic Heritage Month. So I'm going to finish with that project. And I'm going to try to tell you a little bit about the process that we do. One of the things that characterizes our firm is that we don't have a style. Okay? Many of you are starting to study architects. And if you did Ian Pei or Philip Johnson or some of the old ones, or Frank Gehry, you know what the buildings are going to look like. In our case, we like to think differently in that we think that, as you see here, inspired by purpose. That's our motto. And so what does that mean? It's that every site, every client, every environment is different. And our buildings need to react and be inspired by that site, by that climate, and by that client. So what we consider ourselves is our interpreters. And what we're trying to do is interpret what the site, the context, the people. Usually you have two different clients, the client that hired you and the client that uses it. And many times they have completely different goals and objectives, because sometimes the user wants to use the building for something that is not what the owner of the building planned. So we need to get inspired by purpose. What is the purpose of this facility? Purpose of this building is to teach you about architecture. And the building has to speak about architecture like it does now. It's a beautiful building with the opening, the experience. It inspires collaboration. It inspires interaction. It inspires working together in team, as a team, right? Well, the building spoke to you. There's a course I took when I was at Penn called Environmental Psychology, which is studied how the buildings, how the built environment affects people's behavior. Do you all believe that building, the built environment? Let me give you an example. A curved wall like this is inviting. An angle wall, if you're on that side, it looks like it was pushing you back. You felt aggressive. So it is a way that the building teaches or somehow molds us into how we behave in that environment. So what we want to do is obviously is inspire the user of the building into having a life of an environment in which their goals, their dreams are motivated and being able to accomplish them in the best way. So architecture is very romantic because you're talking about touching many people's lives, many people's hearts. So if you feel like this is the field that you want to get into, this is the right career to do. So enough. So we are a firm locally, 16 people, four or five licensed architects. Many in the process of getting their license. It's hard to get a license in architecture, but again, nothing is easy in this career. So I'm gonna talk about a little bit about these projects. I picked four, but there are several. Like for instance, the GECU building. You know the building, the crooked building? It's not because it's a crooked bank, okay? No, they called it the crooked building. I did that building. And so that was in my previous life. So I didn't bring that building because now that I think about it, it would have been great to talk about it. Nevertheless, I picked some of the buildings because I'm gonna talk a little bit about the design process. You are first and second year students, most of you, right? And so you are barely getting going as to what is it about architecture, what is architecture? So what you start is with a site, a piece of property. And that piece of property, it's somewhere. It's somewhere in the street. It has an orientation where the sun hits. Is it vacant? Is it built? How much traffic? What's around it? Is it a creek? Is it flat? Does it drain into it? How am I going to handle all the water? When it rains, it pours, right? And then we have flooding. How are we going to do this? So the first thing you do is you have a site, but you also have a client, and it tells you, this is what I want. This building, and I want it to do it this way, and I want you to do it for this purpose. And we do what is called a program, where we list, like for instance, how many offices do you need? Do you need a gym? Do you need whatever, so on and so forth? And you do that, square footages, and you start designing. Well, this facility, Valle Bajo, it used to be called rec centers, but now it's a community center. The difference is because when it was called a rec center, it was mostly for people your age to go play basketball, volleyball, whatever. But now, and before they had a senior citizen center, and it had a library, and now they put them all together And what you're dealing with is with people of all ages, little kids to the third generation, to the third age. So like people like old like me, so that I can go play bingo, all right? So you have the entire, so that's a very difficult thing because you're designing for kids, you're designing for teenagers, adults, elderly. So that's the program in here. So the project is, it's too bad that it stretches, the TV stretches the image. But it's on Alameda and Carolina. You guys know more or less where it is, here in the bayou, right? And so it was 20-some thousand square feet, and we wanted a basketball court, a library, 3,000 square foot library. They wanted a scene where older people would be able to play bingo and do Zumba and other things like that. And so we had a vacant land. We had a vacant piece of property with a wonderful McDonald's right next to us. Car lot, junkyard. That was my end destination. That was our site. Not very sexy, right? We had Alameda, which is people drive very fast and is the used car capital of the world. Big signs, big signs, big signs, big signs. So how are we gonna do a facility that is an institutional facility and make it so that it really affects its environment? So the first thing that we did is we need to push the building to the front. Push the building to the front so that all of the outdoor activities are in the back and the building protects kids. So we push the building to the front, close we have to Alameda. The shape is a flower. It's a petal of a flower. That's a flower. Because we're in the desert. We try to do the parking in the back, and then we have to capture all the storm drain. When it rains, we didn't have a place to do, so we said, why don't we do a soccer field? We did a depression, about 3 feet, and we did a soccer field. Last but not least, we said, okay, how do we promote outdoor activities that go beyond that? We created an amphitheater for outdoor movies. So but we have to protect it for the sound from Alameda. So one of the buildings comes out and that buffers all the sound. So all of these things you need to think about when you're doing outdoor. So we had a library, and we oriented, if you look at it, the petals of the flower looking out towards the mountain. The mountain is on that side, that's west, but that's the biggest heat gain, so we had to do an overhang for the elderly. Gymnasium, cardio, and free weights, and multi-purpose room. Everybody gathers, all ages, kids, youth, adults, elderly, to the end. So we created two narrow circles that we forced everyone to get together in that space so that the elderly could teach the little kids about life. That was the concept that we did for the building. We started looking at different facades and what different materials, of course. Stucco is commonly used here. We had to deal with budget. It's important, you know. And we used a lot of the stone. But we wanted also for it to be light, very light, just like the flower. So this is how it came out. So we created a base, the building grows. Stone, circle, and then you have a clear story to introduce indirect lighting on the library. And we created this narrow path that pushes everybody to go through that law. So that's how we said it. Everybody has to go through that. If you come from Alameda and you took the Brio or the bus, you have to go through that law. If you come from back, you have to come through that law. And then from there, it's true. So this is the amphitheater is here. We got this thing over here. We have sound and everything. But if you look at it, this building blocks Alameda so that the sound, they can listen to the movie. So it is not become, doesn't become a silent movie. It was opened during the pandemic. So we still haven't seen it used the way it was originally planned. Because it is brand new. It just it's been in operation only 1 year. Obviously, we have to deal with the environment. So how much grass and where we put the grass is important, the turf, and everything else to be with desert landscaping, seriouscaping. These trees, Palo Verde, which are ground color, are now much taller, and that also buffers the sound and the sun from the west. Because these pictures were taken before it opened. So that's why this is where they play Zumba and cards and things like that. Like for instance, you can see the sound buffering material in the ceiling so that when they are yelling bingo, whatever, you know, the sound is not too bad. We have a basketball court. We have a library. The library is no longer going to be building the big library that used to be. Everybody uses a cell phone. In Google, we trust. And however, they support many, many things, laptops and things like that. So it is equipped with all the technology. What happens is that libraries are now becoming teaching areas where you can do ESOL, English as a second language for the elderly, citizenship, things like that. So there is a classroom in there as well. So if you think about all the things that we needed to put together in putting this building that is not a rec center anymore, it's a community center. This is another one. We did three at the same time. One is on Lomalang, this one is on Chamisan, and the Valle Bajo is in Alameda. Now, this project, it is interesting because I mentioned to you before that the site is important, and it's very different. Sometimes you get a flat piece of land like we did at Valle Bajo. In Chamisal, it was an old Levi jean factory that had been added 5 times over 30 years, and it had been vacant for 20 or 30 years when the garment industry left El Paso. So the building was block, concrete block, metal, steel, and an addition that was like this, an addition that was like that, an addition that was like that, an addition that was like that, and whatever. And it was just in really bad shape. So the city of El Paso hired us and they said demolish the building and build a new building. We said no. We said I think that we have an opportunity to reclaim most of the building. And we used the building. And we were able to do, instead of 21,000 square feet of our community center, it's 45,000 square feet. And I'll show you in a minute. So this is the site. This is the warehouse. But this was one addition, another addition, another addition, another addition, another addition. With different materials and at different heights. That's the building. Pretty ugly. Walnut Street. So, how am I doing? Are you okay? So, it was vacant. And what we did, we just demolished this piece. We demolished about this piece. Everything else is still there. Okay? So, La Bui, we have school. Piedra, Altano, that's where the Chavez Health Center is. And it was an ugly warehouse. Or group of work. So we started studying on what to do and what to demolish and not. And what happened is that we said, okay, part of the program was that they had, the city had hired somebody else to do this part. It was not part of our project. So I said, okay, now we don't have an entrance. Somebody else is just using the park. It's a splash park. So we said, okay, where do we enter? There is no parking. There is only angle parking and recycling. And now we have a much bigger building than what for. Because the program called for 21,000 square feet. So what we did is we said, okay, we can demolish the walls but leave the roof and have covered set of basketball courts. Pretty cool. How many do you know in El Paso with shaded basketball courts? I know two. Okay. Then we said, we don't have any parking. Okay, so we knocked out this wall and we had covered parking, a luxury in El Paso. So we had covered parking here. Then in here we said, okay, why don't we create a courtyard so that they can have piñatas, quinceañeras, bodas, etc. And so what we did is we took off the roof but left the structure alone so that the light can go through, and we created a big, big patio. So we did several iterations. And so now you enter the public parking from Walnut Street. These are three basketball courts. You have this playground, and then this is the community center. And then here is where you have that area with the covered outdoor. We studied things, how we were going to do it. And this is how it looks. So this is the entrance. You can barely see here. I didn't bring too many pictures because I didn't want to bore you. But this is the covered basketball courts. This is the entrance. Again, it's a community center. Same program that the other one, with the library, and people of all ages. So we created another net, and so people can come from the splash park, go through the lobby. But this, I'm standing right now over the covered. We took the panels out and we covered them with sandwich panels, translucent, of different colors. Next thing, we like color. We like color. So we have different colors. The light comes through, but you're in the shade. In all of this area, you can have an outdoor cast, party, movies, whatever it is that you want. Instead of having one basketball court, has two basketball courts. Instead of having just the other one doesn't have a competitive, doesn't meet the requirements for competition, this one does. But you can see this was being a column, this was the rigid frame for a building that was from here to there. This was for another building that was here. And like that, there's columns all over the place. So we created, you can see here, that's the tallest part of the building. That's where we did the gym. That's three weights. The two were built at the same time, so that's why it was open during the pandemic. Here we go. So anyway, so there's basketball court over there. There's a library. Same program as the other one, but two times as big. We again used some of our materials, the stone, That's the main lobby. You can see the splash part. You can feel the construction still has the paint. But you can see that that's the bottleneck. The bottleneck that makes everybody come. And you can see the structure. And you can see how we reuse the entire building. So we use the same amount of money for this building, twice as big as the other, same budget, okay? And the reason why I'm saying this is as architects, we need to really look beyond what most people see. And the one thing that we have for our clients and that you must do is create value. Now, value can be measured in numbers and dollars and cents, or quality of life, or both. I am very proud to say that in this one, we gave him a lot of value, because we gave him twice as much in building and a quality of life for the neighborhood, San Vicente. Now, that's a mock-up. They just finished installing the facade into the reason why I don't have a picture, they just removed it. But we said, okay, the facade, we need to do it a mural. They made a competition. The winner was somebody from Bowie High School. And that was a mock-up inside the building, but on the facade, right now you can see that's the facade. That's that mural is on the facade of the building, and it's probably three times as big. Now, talk to you about community center. Now, this is a building that is completely different. It's for Socorro Independent School District, and it's a technology building. And what this building does is they have 70,000 students, so they manage all of your records, they manage all of your, the teachers, all the classes, attendance, everything. It's called a network operating center. Translation, a lot of computers that need a room about this size. They're stacked. They need to have fire suppression system that is dry, because if it's wet, you'll ruin the computer. It has a lot of things. I wasn't allowed to take pictures of it, so we cannot, because it's secure. But it's a very different type of building. Here, they train all of their teachers. They have a library where they teach the librarians. We have what is called a flexitorium, which is an auditorium that you can collapse all of the stair seating and make it flat so that they can have robotics competitions. But you can have two different lectures. So it's a building that has to have a lot of flexibility. And that's where they train all of their teachers and all of their staff members. Very different. The building, told you about a site. So you have Rojas, and this existing building is their headquarters. Who went to Socorro High School or Socorro Independent School District? Anybody here? Okay, so you know where that building is, the headquarters building? I didn't say this, but it's ugly. It's just very tall, three stories high, tilt up, painted yellow. And it's very industrial. And that's their headquarters. So they hired us to do a technology building right next to their building. So we were, okay, first of all, in front of the building, this is dirt, this is parking lot, and then there is this two-story, but it has a high story, yellow concrete building with very few windows. All you see is concrete. And what we said, okay, we need to create something that is a sense of place, a sense of our life. And you're going to hear about when you study further along architecture, sense of place, sense of arrival. When I parked over here, and I came here, that's the sense of life. Guys, you can go through an ugly space or a beautiful space. The distance is the same. What do you want to do? Okay? You need to be inspired and inspire the community, because it's not what you go, the distance that you go, but what you go through. Okay? So, he said, okay, we're going to create an oasis. This was dirt. So that people, all their employees, now we're going to put a building and we're going to shade that oasis so that they can go outdoors and eat. We're going to have a roundabout so that you have a sense of arrival in the bus stop, so that you can have a, what we call a kiss and ride, so they can drop you off, or, you know, your loved one or your kid or your co-worker, whatever. And so this is the end of the building. So that was basically the concept. The other thing is, this is kind of cheesy, it's technology, Wi-Fi. People in my office don't like me saying this. But they think it's cheesy. It is cheesy. It's like too obvious, you know what I mean? But anyway. Okay. So these are the flexitoriums. This is a loading dock where they get all their computers. All 64,000 computers get here, get the loaded their software and this and the other. We have a kitchen lounge because there's 250 people working here. Okay? Conference rooms, called the grand foyer, and then training library and computer labs. That's where they teach all the, or they train all their teachers of how to do all their classes and so on and so forth. The second level, we have, these are all the geeks, all the nerds that maintain the Socorro Independent School District software moving. And they, you know, they have a call center, like for instance, I cannot print, they call over there, you're disconnected to the Wi-Fi, they connect it, they help you, you know the drill. This is the knock. So this is a very different building, very utilitarian, high technology, has more wires than you want to know, has a lot of control access, a lot of technology so that people cannot go beyond certain areas for obvious reasons, because you can mess them up with their, So the thing is, I refuse to do a tilt-up building. You know, you guys know what a tilt-up building is? Concrete tilt-up? Concrete tilt-up building is what you do warehouses with. Okay? And they mostly, let's say the Walmarts of the world and the whatever, it's basically a wall that you build in concrete on the floor, and then with frame, you lift. So it's no, very few openings, and it's concrete. So that's the way the other building is built. I said, I mean, no, we're not going to do a tilt-up. But we had a budget to do. So we, where we could put windows and how we made this building look as a technology building, obviously we were sensitive as to not going on the windows to the west. And this shows exactly the performance of the levels. I just put this so that you know these are the things that you're going to be drawing very soon, building sections. So this is how it came about. Building is up here. These are the canopies for the roundabout. This is supposed to eventually get a sculpture. They haven't commissioned it, so they don't know. But the idea is to put a water fountain and a sculpture here. That's the main entrance. These are the conference rooms. These are the trees before they grow. And the coffee at the break room, because we wanted the break room to be all shaded with the trees, and when you are out eating, that you feel like you are in the forest. Well, with Palo Verde, but nevertheless. Everybody knows what a Palo Verde tree is? Yeah? Okay. No? It's desert tree that puts a yellow flower. They're all over the place, and you don't need to water them. And they're amazing. I love them. The only thing is that there are deciduous. Anybody knows what deciduous means? They drop the leaves. So they're kind of dirty, but anyway. So the idea is the cafeteria is going to be surrounded by trees. Remember the what I told you, the oasis? That's where the oasis is. And this is part of the oasis. The idea is that they're going to put tables and chairs here so that they can go and eat outside. That's the cafeteria. All the glass is facing east. This is the morning sun. Remember I told you that you have to look into where does the building orient itself, so on and so forth. The lobby, flexitorial. Now, the idea is these are collapsible walls, but then this foyer, it's all opened and makes one big area so that they can do the robotics test, competition. And that's why we also have concrete and not carpet. Over there are collaborate rooms for people, for the software people that know more what to do about computers than I care to do. That's their programming rooms. Very high technology. A lot of computers, a lot of screens, projectors, security. That's the library. You can see the building I was talking about. That's the yellow tilt-up building that I must tell you something. When they opened it, board member came to me and says, well, this is too beautiful. What am I going to do with my building now? Paint it. A brighter yellow. Nothing I can against yellow. I'll tell you a story in a minute. Last but not least, I was going to tell you a story. When I started my office, my company, my wife was having my second daughter, and I was working out of my house. And I had just built that new house, and I painted it. It was three cubes. One was purple, like purple. One was lavender, and the other one was pink. So there was a lot of people that started driving around. We lived in a cul-de-sac on the west side. That was the end of the city. It was like where Franklin High School is. All of that was dirt. This is 1990. So people started driving, and then the neighbors sued us because we were causing too much traffic. Guys, it got to the point where there was editorials to the paper, and they were comparing the coloring of the house as the burning of the flag it got really crazy. We got sued. We had to repaint the house because I was broke and I couldn't defend myself. And I said, okay, I'll paint it, but only if you pay for it. So the neighbors paid for the paint of the house. So when I say that, yellow, I had a purple and an orange house. So okay, nothing I can see yellow. I'm not shy about color, And you're going to see that. So this building is under construction. The Mexican American Cultural Center. It's right next. We are the architects actually for La Nube, the Paso Children's Museum. We're working with a firm out of New York called Snoeta, and we're the architects for that project. The architects of record, working in collaboration with them. And this project, we are the designers and the architects of record. And they hired us because they wanted to do, as part of the Quality of Life Bond Program, a Mexican-American cultural center. Not a Hispanic, not a Latino, not a Latinx. It had to be, Chicano. Politicians think, okay, I have nothing to do with it. So then we said, okay, we were hired to do this in an existing building, which is the library, the main library downtown, which the friends of the library hated us because we were going to reduce the size of the library to do part of the building as a Mexican-American. All libraries are getting smaller for because of technology. Nevertheless, they were all very upset. The Mexican-American community was against this project because they wanted to do it in the Abraham Chavez Theater. The budget was half of what we needed. It was an existing building, and we got lucky and we got hired. And we're really, for those of you that me tocó la tigre, la tigre. So it's a Mexican saying about this, like, you don't want to be with a tiger, right? So we started doing research. This is the site. Main library, addition to the library, history museum, Franklin Avenue, University Park, the baseball park, right here. Oregon, right here, the main library. So we had no money, and we needed to basically take this many square, or this half of the building, which is naked, from here to there, total of 40,000 square feet, 20,000 existing, 20,000 new, and do this Mexican-American, which had many things that they wanted to do, a cultural center. Well, what does that mean? What do you think is a cultural center? Anybody? What is the Mexican culture known for? Tacos, nachos, what else? We have a not only tacos, but we have chile picada, music, open music, video, nachos, banda. What else? We paint. We have Diego Rivera, Frida Kahlo. Okay? So, all of the arts. Now we have recording, we have music. So all of that has to be done, one of each. You have to have a ballet class or dance class. We have to have a black box so that where they can train performances. We have to have an auditorium. We have to have kitchen for teaching culinary. You name, you got it, right? You have for painters and sculptors with very little money. So we had to reuse most of the building and demolish the least amount of building to do this project. This is part. Oh, by the way, we wanted to be an amphitheater so that we can have a big, I was going to say that letter of word, big time TV screen about the size of that facade, so that we can have outdoor movies and music and whatever. So this is the outdoor side, and it's part of our work. So you have the map, city library, history. You have the to make things a little bit more juicy, you have the brio, you have the trolley. Brio, trolley. Here also the trolley. You are downtown, so there is no place where to start the construction, where to place all your materials. University Park. So pretty tough. So then we started studying all the connections, pedestrian connections, that the site has with its surroundings downtown. So you have the Quinta Plaza, Southwood Center, the Houston Museum of Art, the Camino Real, Paso Locos, all of the things that the Boston Museum of Art is going to do. Double three. So we said, okay, we need to somehow find a way that this building communicates. And again, what did I say earlier? What you go through, right? Placemaking. And what else did I say? What was the other word? Sense of home. So we needed to do that for this building. And then we started looking at what's around it architecturally. El Paso, my daughter got married. Three women and a man, and two are married. The second one got married Saturday. People came from all over, from Houston and Knoxville, Tennessee, whatever. They were saying El Paso's architecture is incredible. They love downtown. Some other day, if they keep me, they invite me again, I'll tell you about all this rich architecture that we got from Trust and Trust, the architect that did most of the buildings downtown. Talk about leaving a legacy. So we started looking at everything that goes around the materials. You have the brick, you have Sagrado Corazon, El Paso Laundry Building, Plaza Hotel. You guys know that the Plaza Hotel is the first ever Hilton high rise ever built in the United States? The first one. Before they were all motels. So we started looking at that, and then we said, okay, well, guess what? We're at the border. Mexican-American culture. When I first came to El Paso, I was Mexican because I was born and raised in Chihuahua. Then after many years, when I go back to Chihuahua to visit my family, I'm a gringo. So what the heck, you know? I didn't get the blue eyes, I didn't get the money, and I, what's the deal here, you know? So I'm neither, okay? So we are Mexican-American, the border. I'll tell you another story. I used to write for the paper, editorials, and I called the Third Nation. I called one of my editorials. I called it the Third Nation. I still believe that we're in the Third because we have our own food right now. Our own climate, our own language, you know? We speak Spanish. It's fine, I don't mind. Some people are, they wanna either speak English or Spanish. I'm doing it the English way because I'm in a school, okay? Si no, me la pasaba del otro lado. So, Mexican American. So we go, okay, we love color. We started looking at patterns in sarapes. Papel picado. We started looking at patterns that we could do because one of the things that in the architecture that you saw is what do we see a lot in El Paso? Wrought iron. Right? You see wrought iron all over the place. Also, this map represents how we have had the largest amount of Mexican-American influx, but how we have things brought in into the rest of the country and how we have influenced this great nation with our food. Now you go to Chicago and you see more Mexican food at pizzeria, right? And you go to New York and you don't have to learn speak English to get through. Okay, we're all over the place. So, this is what it represents. This represents us and how we have migrated from the border to the north. So, we started saying, okay, that wall is going to represent us, how we have evolved and how we have influence, great influence into the United States. Recognize all of this. So we started doing, we couldn't do a whole lot with a building because it was an existing building. So we demolished the piece here of the library. We added this wrought iron that's perforated, and so that you can put backlits, and so that you can have different colors, and what each one of those penetrations is one of us. And as you go up, how we enter and how we influence this great nation. We created another entrance. Remember that we wanted to say sense of arrival. So now we have a sense of arrival. This is the amphitheater, this is the new entrance, and this becomes a stage so that they can have outdoor or clonical dances. The big, you said it, TV, right? The very large TV. Okay, and then we have also the through him, we went on an outdoor terrace from the top because it's cool. We're going to be out there. We're going to see the baseball. We're going to see people passing by. And we're going to see the La Nube Museum. Trellis is an architectural element that is true to the Mexican culture. And so we started developing, as you can see, these are the Sarape patterns. Okay? And you have now the performance, you have the amphitheater, and this is how it's going to look. So we have the terrace, the screen, the mat. Talk about value. We said, okay, let's give them an Instagram moment. I don't have Instagram, but anyway. That wall is an Instagram moment, a photo shoot moment. This is going to draw people. Talk about creating value because it's about branding the map. So that's the main entrance. That's the entrance, the park, the amphitheater. The art, the landscaping is all desert landscaping. So we think that we did a very regional building that is going to represent us. And that's it.
Thank you, Pacelli. What a great way to start the semester with our lecture series. And perfect, right? I mean, Hispanic Heritage Month came out with this great story for you. Antoine Friedock contacted me to be the Mexican-American expert for this project. And obviously, we didn't get selected, but I'm not upset. That is a wonderful, wonderful design. Thank you. Questions? Anybody have questions for Pacelli?
So when it comes to, like, parks projects, do you, like, interview community members for things that they want in those community centers, or do you, like...
Yes, I didn't mention that because I could be here too long. But part of, remember I told you that you have two different clients, right? The owner of the building, whether it's a hospital, and the patient, okay? Or sometimes there is a third one, which is the family members of the patient, okay? There's another one, the doctor. So before you know it, it gets dicey. So what we did is we developed, and remember I told you that for the Mac, we had people that were upset because they didn't want to have it here. So what we did is we did community meetings, and we did charrettes, which is a fancy word for a workshop. And basically we exchange ideas and we bring images. It lasted 6 days. There were three charrettes, 2 days each. And so they gave us ideas. There's a technique to do it. You bring precedents. People tell you what they need. It's a lot of interview, a lot of back and forth. Not always pleasant. There were people with boards saying that they don't want the building here, so on and so forth. You kind of like have to work around it. And you start guiding and narrowing what everybody wanted and how everybody, because at the end of the day, I hope that when this building opens next summer, is that they're going to say, I took part of that. That building looks that way because I participated. They get ownership. We had both groups, both the library and the MAC against it. And when he went to council with his design, it was unanimously approved. And a lot of it has to do because you have to listen. You have to listen. You cannot find out what inspires, remember, inspires by purpose, if you don't listen to what he said or she said. So a lot of it has to do with patience. It's time consuming. It's not always fun. Because for the most part, people, that was one particular case where it wasn't fun. We were doing the community centers. The ones in Chamizal, they wanted an indoor pool. Well, that was the entire budget, you know? So I said, you know, like, so they were upset that they couldn't do an indoor pool. But for the most part, people like to collaborate. And a lot of it has to do with how you treat them, and you treat them with respect. And you, and when you come back the next time that you mentioned, like you asked, here, like you thought. And there has to be a consensus because sometimes they have opposing goals. And so we say, okay, prioritize. Which one? And they vote. So there's a technique and experience, and that's why I'm losing my hair.
Okay. Anybody here that wants to ask a question? No? All right. I guess that'll be it. Thank you very much, Pacelli. Everybody for joining us here today. What a fantastic turnout. And I welcome you to come in October. We have Diana Davis from Perkins & Will in Houston. And then in November, we're going to have Gabriela Bermea of BLK Architects in Austin. So we've got a good lineup this semester. Thank you very much. We'll see you next time.